touches me most is that I had a chance to work with people, passing on to others that which was passed on to me. We who believe in freedom and that freedom.
Yes, sing it with us. Come on.
We who believe in freedom and that freedom comes to me. Young people come first.
They come first.
They have the courage where we fail. And if I can but shed some light as they carry us through the gate. Secret of my going on is when the reins are in the hands of the young who dare to run against the storm. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. Not needing to clutch for power, not needing the light just to shine on me. I need to be one in the number as we stand against tyranny. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. Struggling myself don't mean a whole lot. I've come to realize that teaching others to stand and fight is the only way our struggle survives. Oh, oh, we who believe in freedom and not rest. We who believe in freedom and not rest until it comes. I'm a woman who speaks in a voice, and I must be heard. At times I can be quite difficult. I'll bow to no man's word. I we who believe in freedom and not rest. We who believe in freedom and not rest until it
Welcome, and thank you for accepting the invitation to join community events hosted by the Solidarity Building Initiative here at McCormick Theological Seminary. I'm Grace Okerson, the Specialty Projects Coordinator and Content Curator here at SBI. And if you're new to McCormick, throughout the year, McCormick offers a wide and diverse range of community events that center on issues of social concern and faith. SBI has a theological education certificate for those detained within Cook County Jail. Their certificate courses intentionally provide students in the carceral system with practical theological education. Students are exposed to a range of interdisciplinary resources and pedagogical practices directed at personal, professional, and social transformation. The public ed advocacy arm of our initiative is really intended to directly support people who are detained, as well as the communities that have been impacted by incarceration. Tonight, we'll be kicking off our social justice advocacy public education series. This four-part series will feature local grassroots organizations advocating for policy change that will create better opportunities for people directly impacted by the criminal legal system. Thank you for joining us as we learn how we and our communities can get involved in the movement to create beloved community with and for those marginalized by the criminal punishment system. Tonight, we are joined by Brianna Payton, a policy analyst at Chicago Community Bond Fund. The Chicago Community Bond Fund pays bonds for people charged with crimes in Cook County through a revolving bond fund. They support individuals whose communities cannot afford to pay the bonds themselves and who have been impacted by structural violence. They have also worked diligently to end pre-trial detention in Illinois. We are really excited to learn more about the Chicago Community Bond Fund and how we can get involved. Before we get started in our conversation, I have a few housekeeping items. We will have a Q&A session with Brianna, so please submit your questions in the chat box or by using the Q&A feature. If you're joining us via Facebook live stream tonight, we are really glad that you're here. We'll be monitoring the comment section of Facebook Live for questions, so please just leave your questions in the comment. Thank you all again for joining us tonight, and I would like to invite Sierra to take us away.
Good evening. I am Reverend Sierra Bakes Chamberlain. I am the Executive Director of Live Free Illinois, and I am so excited to moderate this conversation with Brianna because there is so many eyebrows that are raised and so many questions that are out there concerning the Pretrial Fairness Act and public safety. So Brianna is going to educate us on tonight and clear up any misunderstandings. So Brianna, we'll jump straight into it. Can you tell us a little bit about your role at the Community Bond Fund?
Sure, thank you, Sierra. So my role at the Bond Fund is a policy analyst. So I work on our advocacy team to support all of our efforts to advocate for policies that benefit people who are impacted by pretrial incarceration. So that, you know, heavily includes and centers working as a part of the Coalition to End Money Bond, which is a Cook County-based coalition of organizations that have been pushing for pretrial reform, you know, for 5 years since it was started in 2016, and then as well as a part of the Illinois Network for Pretrial Justice. So we have been, that started in 2019. It's a statewide organization that has been, that's the organization that really pushed the Pretrial Fairness Act, because, you know, we've gotten bond reform in Cook County in the past, but the Pretrial Fairness Act is the first, you know, really comprehensive statewide pretrial reform. And that wouldn't have been possible without people from all over the state, you know, calling their legislators and putting in work to organize around that. And so as a part of CCBF, I help to organize with those two groups. And I also support our other campaigns, including the Budget for Black Lives, which is calling to defund the jail and invest those resources into communities. We've done COVID advocacy. So we don't only advocate for things like the Pretrial Fairness Act, but that is really a huge bulk of our work and one of the things that we're most proud to have gotten pushed through this year.
Awesome. So tell us, Brianna, what is the Pretrial Fairness Act?
So the Pretrial Fairness Act is the historic legislation that got passed in January of 2021, this year. It was championed, it was a part of a larger criminal justice reform bill that was championed by the Legislative Black Caucus, and it was, which was called the Safety Act, but the Pretrial Fairness Act was included in there in full. So the Safety Act is like 700 something pages, the Pretrial Fairness Act is like 300 something pages. that is what it is. And it's basically comprehensive legislation that not only will make Illinois the first state in the country to end money bail, but it will completely reconfigure the entire pretrial legal system. Like, there are multiple elements of the pretrial legal system that are changed as a result of the Pretrial Fairness Act. And so I actually want to kind of pull up a few slides. I'll try not to do my like deep policy dive. I want to spare y'all too much of the details, but I think it would be more beneficial if I could actually just kind of go through a few slides that talk about the different accomplishments of the Pretrial Fairness Act, if that's okay.
Awesome.
Cool. So I will share my screen. Do you all see my slides?
Yes.
Wonderful. So the Pretrial Fairness Act was written with a handful of really important principles in mind that the Coalition to End Money Bond came together and agreed upon when deciding to push for pretrial justice reform, because there is a way to fight for bond reform that can lead to more people being incarcerated rather than less. And so we had to really make sure that we were clear on our values and our principles before embarking on this work to make sure that we didn't end money bond, but ultimately allow the system to be empowered to lock more people up pretrial, because it's not just money bond that's the problem, it is pretrial incarceration. And so we wanted to undermine both of those things. So there are six principles that the coalition organized around and that inspired the Pretrial Fairness Act. And I'll use that to talk to you all about different pieces of the bill and what it does. So the first principle is that money should never be a determining factor in whether someone is free or incarcerated pending trial. And how the bill honors that principle, it completely ends the use of money bond. As of January 1st, 2023, it will no longer be legal to hold someone in pretrial incarceration because of their inability to pay a certain amount of money. It just completely outlaws it and makes it completely obsolete, which, you know, the federal system doesn't use a money bond, but as far as the states, this is the first state to do that. New Jersey has almost completely eliminated money bond, but they still use it in a limited number of cases. So this is the first state to completely abolish it, and it's an opportunity to hopefully show other states in the country that this is possible. So, but the next question is what does it replace money bond with? So the second principle that we organized around was that releases the norm and detention should be the carefully limited exception. This is the standard that is set forth in the Constitution, both federal and statewide. And so we're not trying to do anything crazy here. This is what it's supposed to be. But you all know that sometimes there are laws that are on the books but not being followed. And so we're reinforcing it in this legislation. And we, instead of just saying that the release should be the norm of detention, should be the carefully limited exception, and leaving it up to judges who we don't think will actually follow through on that because they haven't, the bill actually creates what's called a detention eligibility net, which means that only people charged with certain, that most people are mandated to be released pretrial, and only a small minority are even eligible to be considered for pretrial incarceration. So right now, any person charged with any charge can be incarcerated pretrial, but under the Pretrial Fairness Act, most people will not be eligible for pretrial incarceration based on their charge. And even those that are eligible for pretrial incarceration will not necessarily be incarcerated pretrial, because the bill raises the standard across the board that is needed in order to even say that someone can, that to rule that someone must be detained pretrial. So how does it raise the standard? Under the Pretrial Fairness Act, there are three things that must be met in order to justify incarcerating someone pretrial. Not that it can ever really be justified, but in order to even be able to do it. So one, the person must be charged with a qualifying offense. As I mentioned, there are only a small number of cases. And it's not even just split down the middle of misdemeanors versus felony. It's not split down the false divide of violent versus nonviolent. We really excluded as many charges as we could from this, and only took the smallest minority of most serious charges that we knew we wouldn't be able to pass the bill if we didn't include it. But we definitely, we went further than what we think the system would have been willing to go on a normal day. There must be probable cause that the person committed the qualifying offense. So there's a level of proof that's needed. And then there must be no conditions other than detention that will protect the public from a specific, real, and present threat to any person or persons, or prevent the accused person's willful flight from prosecution. So there are two pieces to that that are really important. The specific real and present threat is really important because oftentimes people are labeled as a danger to the community and there's no real justification. There's no real factual basis, but that's used to lock people up pre-trial. And with this standard, you have to really identify who is at risk if this person is released, what is the risk? And it's not something that can just be abstract. And so that raises the standard in that regard. And then the other way that we raise the standard is it has to be to prevent willful flight from prosecution, not just to prevent someone from missing court. In the past, people failing to appear in court in the past and having a past of missed court dates has caused them to be seen as a high risk of failure to appear in the future and then incarcerated pre-trial. But that's not fair. That's not just because people miss court for all types of reasons, including transportation issues, childcare issues, forgetting they had a court date, not knowing they had a court date to begin with. And so the standard is raised from just failure to appear to like, no, you must be preventing willful flight from prosecution. You need to show that there is a risk of willful flight in the case. So this is the way that the Pretrial Fairness Act works. When someone is arrested, if someone's arrested, because the Pretrial Fairness Act also creates an off-ramp where some people can be like not even be arrested and the police just have to release them with a citation. But if they are arrested, charged, and booked into police custody, then only a small number goes to a pretrial detention hearing if the prosecution asks for detention. But they still have to prove and the court has to find those standards that I mentioned to you. And if they can't find those, then the person will still be released. But if they can find those, then that might be a situation where someone might end up incarcerated pretrial. But the vast majority of cases, 90% of arrest cases, will actually fall into the all other charges category. And they will either be released directly from police custody or they will be given a conditions hearing where a judge has to set what their conditions of release are. And then they would be released with conditions. So that is how the Pretrial Fairness Act works. A few other things. So those are the main accomplishments of the Pretrial Fairness Act, you know, ending money bond and having a totally different system and standard for navigating the decision of pretrial release or pretrial incarceration. But there's a few other things that the bill does that are really important. One is with risk assessments. The bill actually limits the use of risk assessments. It doesn't allow them to be the only thing that is used to justify someone being incarcerated pretrial. It also allows attorneys to know what the standards are, what the criteria are in a risk assessment tool, and challenge it in court. Many problems with risk assessments are that they often have racial discrimination and racial bias baked into them. And so this allows it to be challenged in court in case that is affecting someone's case negatively. This is what I just said. fourth principle is that courts should help accused people attend court hearings and restrain their freedom as little as possible while they are legally innocent and awaiting trial. And one of the ways that we honor this principle is that by reforming the warrant process. Right now, if someone misses court, a judge will immediately issue a warrant for their arrest and they will be forcefully brought into custody. But what this bill does is it creates an option for judges to issue a notice to show cause, or basically a request that somebody just turn themselves into the court or report to the court within 48 hours to resolve the issue of them missing court without them having to be marked as missed court, without them having to be taken into custody. And so it just gives a more humane and less harmful option for if someone misses court. It also allows more law enforcement to release more people pre-trial, like I said, with citations and things of that nature, instead of arresting people for, you know, ordinance violations and things like that. And another thing it does is it lessens electronic monitoring restrictions, which I'll touch on briefly next. The way that the Pretrial Fairness Act reforms electronic monitoring is multifaceted. So for one, judges must reconsider ordering somebody to electronic monitoring every 60 days. Even if they order someone to electronic monitoring, they have to reconsider it every 60 days to determine, is this still necessary? Can they be released to something less restrictive? Because electronic monitoring is really, really restrictive. Second thing is people who are on electronic monitoring must be given movement to do essential tasks. This is really important because under the Sheriff's Cook County electronic monitoring program right now, it is 24/7 house arrest. People get denied regularly basic movement to even go to the doctor, the grocery store to get a haircut, basic things they need to do to take care of themselves or their family, they are not able to do. And so the Pretrial Fairness Act requires that people on electronic monitoring get 2 days a week at least to do different essential tasks. It also prevents people on electronic monitoring from being charged with felony escape for minor compliance issues. You know, like felony escape is literally the charge they use to charge someone who has escaped from jail. And they use that on people who have violations, even small technical violations of electronic monitoring. So this will stop that from happening. Someone must be missing for 48 hours before they can be charged with that. And then people must be given credit towards their sentences for any time spent on electronic monitoring or house arrest while awaiting trial. And so this is just recognizing that electronic monitoring is a form of incarceration. It is not an alternative to incarceration like it's often presented to be. And so people should be given credit for time that they spend on it if that is going to be what they are ordered to. And these electronic monitoring reforms actually go into effect starting in January. And actually the last one has already gone into effect, and we've already heard stories of people benefiting from it. There was someone who had an EM violation and would have been sentenced to, had to spend 30 days in jail, and it was like an elderly person, and they were able to instead do, you know, 30 days on a curfew in their home because of the fact that the law has now been made to where EM counts as incarceration. Almost to the end, there's only six principles. So the last few things that it does is, the bill does, is it reforms the process for determining violations of pretrial release. Basically right now, if you have minor violations of your pretrial release conditions, you can be taken to jail like for the rest of your case. It could have been the most minor thing. It could have been you stepped outside on your front porch while on EM. They currently have the power to take you back to jail for the pendency of your case, even for minor things. But the bill, it separates out minor and technical violations versus serious violations, which normally would involve like a new criminal charge. And it doesn't allow your pretrial freedoms to be taken away indefinitely for minor violations. And it creates, you know, smaller sanctions that can be used instead. And it also requires that a violation must be shown to be willful before it can be punished. And so that is one thing. And I see someone added a question. Is it retroactive? That's a good question. I don't think it is, to be honest, but I'm not sure actually, because I think the notion of credit inherently is retroactive. So I have to ask about that. I'll get back to you on that. The last principle is that pretrial practices should be transparent and accountable. And so basically it just requires statewide data collection so that we can make sure this bill is being implemented in the way that it was intended. So I will stop sharing my screen. And I know that was a mouthful, but I hope that you all found it helpful to understand what is in the Pretrial Fairness Act.
Thank you, Brianna, for breaking down the Pretrial Fairness Act. I hope everyone got all of the information they needed. And if not, we're gonna have Q&A. So please write down your questions so that Brianna can answer them later. But continuing on in the conversation, what's happening now since the law has passed?
Since the law has passed, so when it first passed in the legislature, there was a period where we were really fighting for it to be signed by the governor. And there was a lot of pushback from law enforcement and other people who didn't want it to get signed by the governor. So we spent about a month fighting for that. And then Pritzker signed it into law. So after Pritzker signed it into law, we did a little dancing, a little celebrating, and then we kind of started to plan for implementation. And so what's been happening since then is that we've been trying to continue to mobilize people to thank their legislators for passing the Pretrial Fairness Act, because we know that they have been facing ongoing backlash from law enforcement and their sympathizers for passing this progressive criminal justice legislation. And so we have been continuing to kind of mobilize people to do that. But aside from that, we're really just planning for implementation. So like, for example, in Cook County, there are implementation working groups that are starting up, some that have to do with pretrial decision-making, some that have to do with court appearances and how those should go, some that have to do with cite and summons, which has to do with the reforms about how police will need to release people in many situations instead of arresting them. And so there's different working groups that are happening in Cook County and more that are coming at the state level for different stakeholders to be in the room, really talking through and working through how are we going to implement this bill and this law, actually.
So what's included in the implementation phases?
Just literally that. So like meeting, working through processes, developing processes, training stakeholders. So training judges, training public defenders on what it should look like to really change how they operate in the courtroom. Judges are used to having a lot more power to detain. And so what does it look like for them to cooperate with a system that says, actually, you know, not all situations are going to be detention eligible. How can you, how to follow that law, how to implement that. And so really, it's just like a lot of stakeholder education and a lot of working groups really trying to work out what are the new processes going to be. That is really like the main things that have to, those are the main things that are happening with regard to implementation. And also a lot of assessing what already is. So like we're looking at working with with some organizations that can really help us to evaluate what already exists in terms of pretrial decision-making, pretrial practices across the state, so that we can really try to get out ahead of recognizing what might be some of the challenges that might come when it's time to implement this really transformative law.
Now, I know, just going back to the public safety piece of it, there's a lot of people who are concerned and doing finger pointing and sort of blaming the increase of gun violence on letting people out of jail. So can you talk a little bit about how this connects with public safety, and does this pose a threat to public safety?
No. So the legislation, the law that we've gotten passed, does not pose a threat to public safety. A lot of the people and politicians that have been peddling narratives about, you know, bond reform and pretrial reforms driving gun violence are really just reaching for something to blame because they don't have an answer about how they're going to really respond to the violence that is facing our communities. And, but there, you know, the data already shows that what they're saying is just simply false. There is no evidence-based connection between pretrial reforms and violence. You know, there have been some increases in things like homicides this year, over last year, but they've happened all across the country in all types of cities and jurisdictions, ones there where there was no pretrial reforms and ones there where there were pretrial reform. And so this is bigger than pretrial reforms. The majority of the places that it saw an increase did not have any pretrial reforms. And so there's something bigger going on here, maybe, I don't know, a pandemic and other factors, economic downturns, other factors that might be leading to violence being exacerbated in our communities. But the data shows that there's no higher rate of, you know, arrests or missing court or things of that nature when you implement bond reform. And we implemented bond reform in Cook County, and bond use of money bonds went down by 40%. The jail population has decreased, you know, 40% over the last 7 years, and there has not been a corresponding increase in crime. And so it's really just false narratives. And the truth of the matter is, I would go so far as to say there's just not a desire to really invest what's really needed to curb violence in our communities, because we know what makes our communities safe. We know that quality education, that quality economic opportunities, that housing and healthcare and mental health support, these are the things that contribute to community safety. And so as long as politicians continue to lean on the law and order narrative and try to say that we need more incarceration and more prosecution in order to respond to that, it's only going to make the situation worse. And so we are really pushing for people to really see through these narratives and to continue to put their faith in what we know works, what has evidence base behind it, to really promote community safety.
Awesome, because law enforcement strategies and the carceral system does not stop violence or prevent violence anyway. So there was a lot of work that went into passing this bill. Can you talk about the coalition building, the organizing that it took, and then also specifically to the faith community and their role in helping to pass this bill?
Yes, absolutely. So Yes, organizing and coalition building was essential to this work. Without that, this work would not have gotten done. The Coalition to End Money Bomb started, like I said, back in 2016. And it takes, you know, multiple organizations to really build the power to do what was done in Illinois. No one person, no one organization can do it. And so in the the Coalition to End Money Bond alone, there are like 16 organizations in Cook County. And then in the Illinois Network for Free Trial Justice, there are over 30 organizations, and they have organized their people. And it was really a team effort that was required in order to get this done, especially pushing legislators that were more on the fence. You know, not everybody that voted for our bill was going to vote for it in the beginning. It took lots of meetings. It took lots of explaining the policy. It took lots of justifying. And that takes people, you know, because people are not going to just listen to one person or one organization, but they will listen when their constituents and community members are turning out in numbers. And so coalition building was central, and not only just building a coalition, but building a coalition that is based on principles. I have been told that the Coalition and Money Bond spent at least 6 months really, really hashing out the principles that we were going to organize around to push for the end of Money Bond. Because like I said, there was a way to end Money Bond that would have resulted in more people being incarcerated, and that would not have been a win, even if it looked like it on the surface. And so we really had to organize around, okay, how are we going to end Money Bond in a way that actually decreases the power of the state to detain people? How are we going to do this in a way that decreases pretrial incarceration? And so being on the same page about that North Star has helped with shaping the policy. It's helped with shaping the conversation. Even being on the same page about the fact that we are not going to give in to the misdemeanor felony binary or the violent nonviolent binary, because that excludes so many of the people that we're trying to advocate for. And so being principled, it has been definitely key. Being a principled coalition has been key, not just being a coalition. So yeah, that's what I would say to that. And yeah, it's been people power. You know, people forced, for example, the Supreme Court to hear out community members when talking about pretrial issues. We had people like trying to write into the Supreme Court to make a rule about Money Bond. And even though the rule didn't happen, they ended up doing a listening tour. They ended up putting out a report on pretrial practices. These things add up together to build a greater case for ending Money Bond as we were trying to do so.
And so we talked a bit about the policy, the process, organizing. Can we just ground this into community a bit? And can you sort of just paint a vision on why this is necessary in the first place? And how is this going to impact Black and Brown communities across the state?
Absolutely. So one, I also realized that I didn't hit the second part of your last question about faith communities. I mean, faith leaders were critical in the passing of the Pretrial Fairness Act. They used their grounding in values and tenets of faith to really make a compelling case for why we need to fight for freedom. You know, they invoked the sanctity of people's lives. They invoked the fact that we are made in the image of God. They invoked the fact that that God is a God of justice. They invoked all of these different things and really spoke to people who maybe would not have listened to the importance of this issue if it wasn't explained to them through a faith lens. And so many times people separate their faith from justice when like faith and justice should be inextricably linked. And so the role of the faith community in making that link apparent and raising their voices, even if it wasn't popular, especially in different parts of the state, that was critical. It was essential. We had a faith leaders press conference about the Pretrial Fairness Act. We had a day of prayer for pretrial freedom. We had just many different ways in which faith leaders were using their voices, their influence to make this happen.
Powerful.
Yeah.
All right.
So you said, why is this necessary in the first place? So
yeah, why is it necessary? But then really getting to how is this going to transform or impact individuals, particularly Black and Brown individuals across the state?
Absolutely. So the reason that this is necessary is because the bond system, the pretrial system, is the front door to mass incarceration. It is the point through which most people enter. And so it's like, if you know, they say an ounce of prevention is worth a whatever, a pound of reaction or whatever they say. Basically, if you can get at it on the front end, you can probably prevent a whole line of negative domino effects down the line. And that is what the pretrial decision-making process does, because it is one of the most important parts of someone's case. Because if you are incarcerated pretrial, you're more likely to get sentenced to jail. You're more likely to be sentenced to prison. You're more likely to get longer sentences. So it's feeding mass incarceration. It also makes you more likely to be arrested in the future, you know, because it destabilizes your life and makes it hard to succeed. And so it just creates a cycle. And so what the Pretrial Fairness Act is doing is creating off-ramps as early as when you encounter the police, saying, wait a minute, okay, you encountered the police, but do you actually need to arrest them though? Or can you just give them a citation and let them go? People get arrested for things that are ordinance violations that are ultimately only going to be fined. So why are you taking them into custody? You know, and you're giving them an experience, you're entangling them in this system that doesn't want to let people go. And so it's like, if we're able to stop it earlier, who knows how much harm can be prevented down the line. You know, when people are incarcerated pretrial, the types of consequences they experience are not just with their case and being coerced into a plea deal, because that's another thing. You know, when you're in jail and your life is being ruined because you're in jail, even if you're innocent, you might just plead just to get out. You know what I mean? Just to get out sooner rather than later, because these cases can take so long. And so people are being coerced into taking these deals and into accepting incarceration. Because while they're in jail, what's happening to them? They might have just lost their job because you missed a day at work and you had no way to call in and even tell your boss what's going on. And even if you tell your boss what's going on, I'm in jail isn't going to make him necessarily want to keep you as an employee. And so people lose their jobs. People lose their jobs, their source of income. What goes next? The bills that they were paying, the family that they were providing for. So people lose their homes when they're incarcerated pretrial. People get evicted. Their families get evicted while they're in jail and they can't do anything about it. Your family gets evicted. You can't take care of your family. What's happening as a consequence of that? People are losing custody of their children. People are not in place to be there for their family that they love and would do anything for, but they're behind bars. You lose custody of your children. You may never get them back. It may take years to get them back. So these are literally sometimes irreversible consequences that people are facing in their lives. And it's because of an accusation. It's because of something that has not even yet resulted in a conviction and may never result in a conviction. The case could be thrown out. They could be found not guilty, but the damage is already done. And the damage is done to Black and Brown communities, Black, Brown, and poor communities. That is who is affected by money bond. And because when you're Black, you're twice as likely to not even be released on bond or to be given a higher bond. And so it's like every racism permeates every step in the system. So you're either likely to be given a higher bond if you're Black or Brown. You're less likely to be given bond if you're Black or Brown. You're less likely to be able to pay the bond if you're Black or Brown because of the wealth gap. You know, it disproportionately harms our communities. And so, of course, the Pretrial Fairness Act will help our communities. It will help Black and Brown communities. It will help people who have been impacted by pretrial incarceration and not given a voice for so long because people just were not aware of the issue. People will be able to stay home with their families. People will be able to take care of their kids. People will be able to maintain their jobs while they're fighting a case. And these are things that can help them keep their sanity, because going through a court process, going through a case can be so stressful. And so being able to stay connected to your support system and the things that make your life stable can be a matter of life or death. Literally, the suicide rates in jails are 3 times that of the population. And when you control for all other variables, they're still twice that of the population. And so jail is a very deadly place. And so the more people that we can keep out of jail, the more families that will be impacted and the more that our communities will be safer.
Wow. So it is very important that we continue to support and push, not just because this big law was passed, but because of everything that Brianna just named, which is so powerful and needed in our basic necessities, right? That a lot of people take for granted that folks are deprived from. Again, like you said, having the ability to be connected to their loved ones, having the ability to have to not be incarcerated or not be denied bail just because of their income status or because their zip code. So this is so important for us to continue to make sure that this is implemented correctly. Do you have any concern about anything that could happen in Springfield, anything happening with the legislators? Are there any concerns regarding this bill that we should be aware of?
Yes, there are a number of concerns. So one is that a legislative win is not an irreversible win. We, you know, there can be, just as you can write and pass progressive legislation, somebody can write and pass legislation that's literally meant to reverse everything that your legislation does. So we are keeping a vigilant eye on Springfield to make sure that conservative and law enforcement backed legislators do not try to or do not succeed at passing legislation that would undo the Pretrial Fairness Act before it essentially even goes into effect. So that is one major concern. The other concerns are more so outside of Springfield and have to do with what are people going to try to start leaning on when they can no longer incarcerate people pre-trial. So we have made it to where many, many cases and charges are no longer going to be eligible for pre-trial incarceration. And what do we think that judges and communities are probably going to try to lean on as their next best bet? Electronic monitoring. And so we don't want counties to be building, expanding electronic monitoring programs, because we have seen time and time again how electronic monitoring can ruin your life just like jail can. And so we are trying to be vigilant about resisting the expansion of incarceration. I definitely want to shout out James Kilgore and Media Justice, an organization that is heavily, that's really leading the way, not only in Illinois, but nationally in resisting incarceration, which is another term for electronic monitoring. And so that's definitely an area of concern and an area where we're trying to raise awareness. We also want to resist the expansion of risk assessments. Again, when someone is not able to just so easily detain people pretrial, we don't want them to start leaning on risk assessments that have, just racism baked into them. And for that to be affecting pretrial decision-making in a negative way, because those contribute to racial disparities and has been shown to do so time and time again, statistically. Lastly, we really do not want the expansion of coercive and surveillance-based pretrial services. A lot of times what is called pretrial services is just forcing people to check in with the probation officer, forcing people to get drug tested, which is, by the way, outlawed under the Pretrial Fairness Act, but forcing people to, maintain all these conditions that if they violate them, they can end up in jail. And so we have definitely in the Pretrial Fairness Act changed how some of those things work as far as, decreasing some of the penalties for violations and things of that nature. But overall, we do not want to see the expansion of surveillance and punishment-based pretrial services to be extended throughout the state. And so those are the things that we're guarding against. The Administrative Office of the Illinois Courts is going to be overseeing the pretrial services across the state. And so we're hoping that that will yield something better than what we might have seen if counties were left to their own devices.
So are there any services that are connected? So if someone is released, are there any services that they will be provided with that's connected to the law?
Well, the law did not legislate pretrial services because we already knew that in the implementation that the government was going to establish it. But we were hesitant and did not decide to legislate pretrial services for the reasons that I just mentioned about the fact that they are always so punitive and can really just cause people to get further and further entangled into the system. So it's not that we don't think people should have the support they want, but they should get that support in the community and on their own terms and what they decide they need when they want to pursue it, as opposed to it being tied to their criminal legal case and something that's forced upon them and that they're punished if they don't, for example, enroll in a substance use program or things of that nature.
Awesome. So Brianna, is there anything else that you think that we need to know? Is there anything that you want to speak directly to the faith community on how to take action or how to get engaged? Anything else that you think we need to know?
Well, one, pray for us. Pray for this movement. Pray for this legislation to be implemented as intended. Pray for changes of hearts for people, especially law enforcement and people kind of on that right wing side of things who just kind of oppose anything that is seen as progressive reform to the criminal legal system without really thinking about how they would want the system to operate if somebody that they loved were involved in it. Pray that there would be less division and less seeing it as an us versus them, and really trying to figure out how we can move forward together, because we are all negatively impacted when our systems are this oppressive. So that is one, because the power of prayer is often underestimated. And that's just me speaking personally, you know, from my perspective into the faith community. But also definitely plug into our work. You know, you can visit chicagobond.org, or, and I can drop this in the chat, you can follow us at Shy Bond Fund on Twitter and on Instagram. We're on Facebook, and same with the Coalition to End Money Bond. We're always putting out articles and educational things, as well as if we ever have a call to action, we will put that out on our newsletter or our social media. And so if you want to be kind of able to tap into those calls to actions when they come, that is the place to go, is to follow us on social media and to subscribe to our newsletter. We don't send stuff all the time. We send things about once a month, and only more if there's some kind of urgent action that's needed. But I think that's the best way to really plug in. But really just raising awareness of this issue in your networks, because it's such an important issue. And just because this legislation got passed doesn't mean that our work is done. So I also dropped the website to our coalition, and on those websites, you can subscribe to our newsletters and you can follow us on social media. I'll drop our handles as well.
Awesome. So at this point, if you have questions, please write them down. Don't forget them. If you have any questions pertaining to the Illinois Pretrial Fairness Act. I want to take a second to switch over and talk a bit about Brianna. And I just want to hear how you got into the work and how your faith guides your work, because oftentimes we talk about the issue, but the thing that sustains us in this work is our faith and our root values that help drive this work. So I think it's important for us to hear. So we would love to learn more about you, what drives you, and how your faith guides your work.
Yes, I'm happy to share that. So how did I get involved in this work? Really, you know, I started to get activated around issues regarding the criminal legal system in high school. You know, I was a senior when, you know, the Trayvon Martin case was blowing up, and that definitely had my attention. But I think that it was really college where I started to learn about and understand things related to social inequality. At a deeper level, I was a sociology major at Princeton, and I minored in African-American studies, American studies, and Spanish language and culture. And just in my classes, I was just starting to understand, like, oh, this is where income inequality comes from. It's not just about, you know, what they're always telling us, which is that if you work hard, you get a good job, you make a lot of money. It's also about what class were you born into, what opportunities were available to you, things of that nature. So that just started to really shift my perspective a bit. I never did buy into those victim blaming narratives, but I did not necessarily have an alternative narrative to defend. And so, you know, my time at Princeton gave me just language for understanding the way that social inequality is produced and reproduced, especially through public policy. And then the Black Lives Matter movement really erupted during my time at Princeton as well. And, you know, Mike Brown was killed the summer after my freshman year of college, and Eric Garner not long after. And we watched as our first Black president announced to us that Darren Wilson would not be indicted for killing Mike Brown. And we were just tired, you know, and we were not the only ones on my campus, but we were feeling the rage that we were feeling, the sadness that we were feeling was something that was reverberating throughout the nation. And so in kind of almost in concert with all these other people across the country, we rose up and we went and just took to the streets in protest just spontaneously. And we kind of shook Princeton because it was this, you know, quiet, predominantly white, very privileged, very wealthy university where people felt comfortable ignoring these things or didn't even realize they were ignoring these things because they were just kind of living in their own world. And so we really shook the campus up and started to organize protests and tell people, like, you know, Black Lives Matter and this is happening and we need to honor the lives that are being lost to this and also prevent more lives from being lost. And then just coming out of Princeton, I just knew that I wanted to continue doing that type of work. And that's what I moved to Chicago to do. And that's kind of how I ended up here. And so as far as the way that my faith informs my work, it's everything to me. You know, my faith informs everything that I do in life. I think that I didn't always initially see the connection between faith and justice, but it was during my time in college when I was simultaneously growing in my faith and growing in my commitment to justice that I started to see how those things overlap. It came from things like reading the Bible and realizing what God says about justice all throughout the Old Testament, or even reading the New Testament in ways and seeing how Jesus was challenging social norms and social inequality in ways that maybe don't always get expounded upon if you're not in a church or in a setting where they're really reading it and noticing or lifting up those things. I started to see that, you know, God hates injustice and God is a God of justice. And the passion that I had for justice, I slowly but surely started to see confirmation after confirmation that that passion was put in me by God. And so I feel called to this work because of my faith. I feel like I feel like I've been gifted and graced for it. And I feel like I've been given a passion for it that is from God, because God cares about justice. And so that is what really drives me in this work, to feel like I'm doing work that I was meant to do because it needs to be done, because God cares about communities that are oppressed, unlike what many, you know, oftentimes right-wing white evangelical spaces will tell you. That is not the God that I know. And it is my mission not only to stand for justice, but to make the God of justice known in this world.
Rihanna, this is awesome.
Thank you
for sharing so much about yourself and your faith, and how it guides your work and how it also intersects with your work at Community Bond Fund. At this moment, we're going to move a little earlier than planned to our Q&A session. So if you're on Facebook Live, Grace will catch your comments or your questions in the chat on Facebook Live. And if you're in our session on Zoom, please use the Q&A chat or the regular chat, and we'll answer any questions or just any comments that you have during this time. So currently we do have a question in the chat for Brianna. So Brianna, which organizations were involved in pushing the Pretrial Fairness Act? What other policies do they plan to push next?
So before I get to that question, I also want to answer Avalon's question about whether the EM provision is retroactive, because I did seek some clarification from my team. And basically the EM credit provision is actually already in effect as of July 1st. So it isn't necessarily retroactive, but it is already in effect. So that is a wonderful thing. And, you know, but credit in and of itself is kind of inherently retroactive, like I was saying. So I do think that it'll benefit people that were on EM prior to July 1st, because when it's time to calculate how much credit they have, it will start from when they got on EM. So, so that aspect of the EM provision is in effect and will have probably likely retroactive effects. But the rest of the EM provisions will go into effect in January 2022 and probably will not be retroactive. I hope that is helpful. As for which organizations were involved in pushing the Pretrial Fairness Act, so the Coalition to End Money Bond and the Illinois Network for Pretrial Justice. If you want to see all the organizations that are listed, you can go to endmoneybond.org/aboutus, and you can literally see every organization. I'll name some, but it won't be all of them. So just know that if you want the full list, you can definitely go online. But you know, CCBF is one. Chicago Appleseed Center for Fair Courts, Illinois Justice Project, Shriver Center on Poverty Law, SOUL, Southside is Organized for Unity and Liberation. Statewide, we have Black Lives Matter, Bloomington Normal. We have United Congregations of Metro East. We have Faith Coalition for the Common Good. The list just goes on. There are lots of organizations and people supporting this work. And we're so thankful and excited to be in community with them. And you can see them all on our website at endmoneybond.org/aboutus. And as for the policies that we're pushing, we are not necessarily moving on from the policy that we passed for the reasons that I said. Like, it still requires defense. It still requires that we are on our post, because we know that people want to undermine it and repeal it and change it before it ever goes into effect. So one, we're still heavily focused on defending that policy. And then we are still trying to push for related policies, policies that are related to implementation to be progressive. So like I said, for pretrial services to not become something that is mandatory and used to punish people, but that it would be something that supports people, for electronic monitoring to not expand unnecessarily, for, you know, for risk assessments to not expand unnecessarily. So we're like pushing for policies that are still related to our overall mission to end money bond. And that has to do with the fact that we are a coalition to end money bond, and we are the Illinois Network for Pretrial Justice. So all of our work will always focus on the pretrial system because there's so much work to be done.
All right. Do we have any other questions from the Zoom room or from Facebook Live? So I don't have any questions popping up yet. So I'll ask a quick question. I know you mentioned earlier, Brianna, that a few ways that folks can pray, and I can't remember the, I think you said something else, but like, what are some concrete action steps if people really want to get involved, if they want to get their congregations involved? I'm pretty sure like even being able to educate and provide some mm-hmm. educational material would be helpful for folks. Can you sort of go back and repeat how can folks support and take concrete action steps? Because as you said, there are some concerns, and we want to make sure that we're continuing to strengthen the power base. So how can the churches and organizations continue to support?
One thing that I was suggesting was that people plug into our social media. So that is where we are constantly sharing educational materials, things that can be shared in their networks. If you want to invite someone from our coalition to come and speak about the Pretrial Fairness Act as a way to contribute to raising awareness, I'll drop my contact information, because that's another way that you can support. I also am going to drop the link to an Action Network form that you can fill out to send your legislator a thank you if they supported the Pretrial Fairness Act, or a shame on you if they didn't. Those are the main things right now, like following up with legislators, partnering with us to raise awareness about this, either by posting and sharing on social media, or talking to people in your network, reaching out to us to invite us to give presentations like this one so that more and more people can be educated about this transformative law, and tapping in with us, like I said, online, so that if there is a time when it's time to take action, that you can be on our newsletter so that we can share that with you. So I'll drop the link to subscribe to our newsletter in the chat as well. It's just endmoneybond.org/news or chicagobond.org/news. And so if you join either of those mailing lists, we send a lot of the same stuff, because there's a lot of overlap between what CCBF does and what the coalition does. And so if you join either or both of those newsletters, that will also be a chance for you to stay in the loop and be able to plug in to take action when the time comes.
Awesome. Now we do have another question in our chat. To follow up on the EM credit question, are you considering a trailer bill that will allow EM credits to apply towards supervised release if they have already been released from prison? Or does it already do this?
I'm not sure if it already does this or not, but I feel like at least the situation about like time in the house counting towards incarceration, I think it was somebody that wasn't pretrial. I think it was somebody that had an EM violation during mandatory supervised release who was able to be in their home instead of taken back to jail due to a violation. So I think there are ways in which the credit, EM counting as incarceration does benefit people who are not pre-trial, but I do not think that we are working on a trailer bill about EM. And I'm honestly not positive about exactly if, I think that the EM credits, I don't think that they're meant to apply towards mandatory supervised release. Illinois just has some problems with mandatory supervised release, but I think that what they're meant to do is actually to decrease time that people spend in the physical jail. So I don't think that time spent on EM pretrial can be used to lessen time spent on mandatory pretrial release post-conviction, because there's a whole nother wave of reform that is needed for mandatory supervised release in and of itself. Thank you for that question. That is a really important issue.
We have a thumbs up, so you answered the question. And with that being said, if we don't have any other questions.
I think there's one more question in the chat from Facebook Live.
All right.
Do you want to read it out? And I'm also going to plug in my laptop real quick. It's starting to die. One second.
All right. While she's plugging up, can you hear me, Brianna? Oh, yep. Here you are. Are there resources that you suggest about learning more about mass incarceration in the city? You're muted.
Sure. I think if you want to learn about the history of policing in Chicago and how that leads to mass incarceration, Simon Balto's book, Occupied Territory, could be a good read. If you want to learn about some of the injustices of the bail system, Alec Kerr Kasanis has a book called Usual Cruelty, and that's a really good read. I think that if you want to follow, what else would I recommend for learning about mass incarceration in Chicago specifically? I'm assuming that's what this question is for. I mean, I think that like mass incarceration like takes different shapes in different cities, but I think it mutates differently in different cities, but it also has a lot of things in common across the board. So sometimes books that are coming out on a national level can really still teach you a lot. So I know that one really good one that recently came out by Derica Purnell is called Becoming Abolitionists. And CCBF is an abolitionist organization. And so I think learning about abolition and learning about ways in which policing has not kept us safe, that jails and prisons have not kept us safe, is always going to be enriching. I think that reading the Department of Justice report on the Chicago Police Department would be very telling. To really understand the abuses that people undergo at the hands of police, so that you can better understand why we're saying to defund police and why we should not continue to pour resources into the system that is not broken, but that is doing exactly what it's supposed to do by oppressing people in our communities. Yeah, I feel like there are more critical resistance is a great hub for resources on abolition to better understand that. Yeah, I feel like there's probably more things, but that should be a good starting point.
All right. So Brianna, thank you again for sharing so much needed information. What I'm gonna ask is that you give us your closing thoughts, again, call to actions, anything that you're taking away from the panel. And after you speak, we're going to turn it back into the hands of Grace. So I'm going to say thank you for allowing me to moderate this panel. I enjoyed this conversation, and I'll turn it back to Brianna for closing thoughts.
Thank you, Sierra, for moderating. I enjoyed the conversation with you as well. Thank you to everybody that's in attendance. I don't really have too much to add. We've gone over the policy. We've gone over ways that y'all can plug in. I guess the only thing that I would add is just to say thank you. Thank you to those that are tuning in on a Wednesday evening when you could be maybe doing other things and you're using your leisure time to really plug into this work. Thank you for those that have taken action to support this work in the past. Thank you for those who are interested in plugging in to take action to support this work in the future. Without community support, it just doesn't happen. So we really appreciate you all. That's all I have to say is thank you all so much.
And you know what? I'm so sorry that I closed, but there is a question that did not get answered. So Brianna, if you can answer this question, and then Grace, we'll turn it back over to you, but I didn't want to miss it. Does the act create alternative pathways or supports for people who are criminalized and detained for their mental health and chemical dependency?
Yes. So under the Pretrial Fairness Act, drug-related charges are not detainable. So we're hoping that this will really benefit people who might have been criminalized for substance use. That is one of the main things about the Pretrial Fairness Act that we think can be. And then a lot of things that are a lot of petty charges that are often levied to get people who are struggling with substance use into custody are just not detainable. And so we really think that will help so that people are not being taken into jail and forced to go cold turkey off of substances and be at risk of, you know, unnatural, you know, be at risk of overdose and withdrawal and things of that nature. And because we believe that people should be able to seek support in the community. So we will always, you know, raise our voices to say there should be more treatment resources in the community. But we did not in the legislation dictate what people's path to support should look like, because we really believe that people should be able to make those decisions on their own terms. We just know they shouldn't be in jail, because we have seen time and time again how jail harms people who are dealing with mental health and substance use. And we just want to continue to advocate for greater investment to be put into community so that people can access that support from within the community. And the same thing applies to mental health. A lot of the petty things, the petty charges that are used to, you know, criminalize and incarcerate people who might be dealing with mental health issues are likely not going to be, are not detainable under the Pretrial Fairness Act. And so we're hoping that again, that people who are facing those types of issues will be able to seek support on their terms in the safety of their communities. That's a great question.
Thank you so much for being with us tonight, Brianna, and hearing about the work at Chicago Community Bond Fund. We're really grateful that you chose to join us this evening. Thank you for your rich questions and thoughtful engagement. And to all those that attended, I hope that each of you were as enriched as I was. And I hope that really in this conversation, that it was generative and really cultivating your works of justice in your communities. Before we say goodnight for the evening, I have a few upcoming items that I would like to share with you all. We will be having three more public education sessions, the next one being on October 20th, where we'll hear from Marlon Chamberlain and our moderator tonight, Sierra, concerning the Fully Free campaign to end permanent punishments in Illinois. You can learn more about our upcoming events by following us on Facebook and Instagram at SBI McCormick. And to support the work of SBI and to learn more about all of our different programs and pillars, you can visit our newly launched website at sbimccormick.org. So thank you all for joining us, and I hope you all have an amazing rest of your evening. Yeah.